Benji, are we ready to go live?
Of course, I'm ready.
I'm speaking with one of my
friends.
We are live.
Are we live? Yes. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Scottish Mission Youth Department Equipping Seminars entitled How to Read and Apply Ellen G. White Writings Today. And this afternoon will be led by the youth group from Irvine, and Adi is the youth leader there. Adi,
yep,
to you for the introduction.
Thank you, Pastor Claudio. So just another warm welcome to everyone. Thank you for participating. And just before we start, we'll actually have just a special item. It wasn't prepared by Irvine Church, but it was chosen by Irvine Church. So I'm just going to put it up right now, actually.
There is no audio.
Is there no audio? Right. Give me 2 seconds.
My faithful Father, enduring friend, your tender mercies like a river with no end, it overwhelms me, covers my sin. Each time I come into your presence, I stand in wonder once again. Your grace still amazes me. Your love is still a mystery. Each day
the
Can everybody hear me? Thank you. So just before we start, let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity that you have given to us to all meet together and worship you. I especially pray for our speaker tonight, that you may bless him and you may give him wisdom to pass along your word that you want to give to us. And as we leave tonight, that we may be wiser and stronger. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So tonight's speaker is Radisa Antic. He's curator of the Ellen G. White Center at Newbold College and also president of the Theological Seminary in Belgrade. Radisa Antic, I'll pass it on to you. And hopefully God blesses you tonight.
Thank you. Good evening to everybody. It is really my privilege to talk to you tonight. As you know, what Claudius told me, that we have time from 5 to 7. So I'm supposed first to speak for I don't know how long, as the Spirit leads. And then we will have Q&A. So you can ask whatever you want. It doesn't mean that I know all the answers, but I'll do my best. And we can discuss. If I don't know, maybe somebody else in the group knows. I'll need to share screen. So if somebody, the host or whoever, is sharing. If you stop sharing, it would be good. I don't know who is.
Thank you.
You can make now, so you can share.
Okay.
So I can share.
Yeah.
Good. Okay. I think we will have at least fruitful discussion, and this is already something. Let's go to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 24. So we have there from verse 13 on, we have the description of the psychological state of the apostles after the crucifixion of Jesus. And as you know from the Gospels, it was one of the most confusing, difficult, discouraging times in the life of the apostles. They walked with Jesus on the dusty road of Palestine for 3.5 years. They have hoped, as you are going to see in the text, they have hoped that the new kingdom will be established. Unfortunately, it did not happen. Their leader, the Messiah of their lives have been on the cross, and it was a huge disappointment. You know that only Peter had the courage to come there close, maybe John, but most of the apostles, they withdrew to the small room. Up to this day, we do not know the geographical location in Jerusalem of that room where the apostles withdrew, because the city of Jerusalem was filled with pilgrim, with people who came for the Passover festival. And probably they waited for them to leave the city, and then they were planning to go back to the north of the country and to try to think and what will happen with their lives. But two of them could not stay anymore in that room. And we do not know whether we are talking here about two males or maybe husband and wife. When you read Greek text, it is not clear. The names, some commentators believe that it is husband and wife, while others believe that these two people are two disciples. They couldn't stay in that probably small room anymore. They had to go for a walk. Today, if you fly to Tel Aviv, and then you know that the planes are not flying to Jerusalem, but to Tel Aviv, and then they take you by bus or by car to Jerusalem. If you come from Jerusalem down to Tel Aviv, Emmaus is on your right side, and there is a big sign on the highway, and that highway was not always there. It was during that war that Israel had with Arabs, and they came overnight with bulldozers and they made that highway. So the city of Emmaus is on the right side if you come down from Jerusalem. And verse 13 says, now that same day, two of them were going to the village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. Please notice this sentence. They were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people." Then verse 21, "But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of the women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of them of our companions went, but they didn't see," and so on and so on. So this is the psychological profile of the apostles during these difficult times, confusing times. This confusion was not only emotional confusion. This confusion was also theological conclusion. We have hoped, this is how we understood the scripture, that he is going, when Jesus was entering into the city of Jerusalem on Thursday afternoon, there was a Roman fortress, Antonia, just on the left side of that road. They have hoped that he is going to take power in his own hands. And I think this was the happiest day in the life of the apostles, because the crowds were there. They are singing this strange hymn, Hosanna to the Son of David. It means here is the new king. Judas was happy. And when we study the psychology of Judah, you know, he did not betray Jesus because of money, but he had his own plans. He didn't want to go where Jesus wanted him to go. He wanted Jesus to go where Judas wanted him to go. And Judas, you know, he hanged himself. He could not. Different theological perceptions. We have hoped, and the confusion was total. And the disappointment was amazing. And then comes verse 27. I'll try to write something here. So verse 27 says, and beginning with Moses, this is Jesus now speaking, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets. So Jesus starts with Torah, with Moses and all the prophets. He hermeneo, this is the Greek word, hermeneo. He explained, he hermeneo, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the script, in all the, please notice this, in all the scriptures concerning himself. Was, and this is where we have the word hermeneutics, and hermeneutics is the study how we should interpret scripture. But not only scripture, but also Ellen White's writings. And as you are going to notice this afternoon, I'm going to go always from scripture to the writings of Ellen White, because sometimes we have different understanding of the Bible and then different of the writings of Ellen White. If the writings of Ellen White and the Bible have the same level of inspiration, we should apply the same hermeneutical rules. And what happened once Jesus explained? What happened with the confusion and anxiety? So the text says that, for example, verse 31, then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. While they had wrong hermeneutics, they could not recognize Jesus. Once Jesus explained, suddenly they see him clearly. And then verse 32 says, they asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened, hermeneo, and opened the scriptures to us. So, and suddenly everything has changed. Verse 33, they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. These two disappointed people, they didn't want to go to Emmaus anymore. They returned to Jerusalem, and there they found 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, it is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon. Then the two told what has happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. So right hermeneutics is not an option in theology. It is a must. If we want to have a healthy theology, it is extremely necessary to know how we interpret Ellen White's writings and the scripture. So I can speak forever about this, but this afternoon I'll start with giving you some basic hermeneutical rules, and then I'll give you some examples from the Bible and from the writings of Ellen White. The first hermeneutical rule you all know probably, sola scriptura. And you know, it means only scriptures, but this is not easy for us Adventists, not only for us Adventists, it is not easy for any church. Here we are talking about the sources of authority. We are asking the question, what are the sources of authority for our theology. But before I come to Adventist position, let me tell you a few words about, for example, Roman Catholic Church. If you ask Roman Catholics, the church members of Roman Catholic, why they believe what they believe, they will never tell you. If they know their church's position, they believe what they believe because the Bible says so. No. They, in the Roman Catholic theology, since the Council of Trent in the 16th century, it is clear that the first source of authority is Holy Magisterium. This is the church and the cardinals. Church and the cardinals. So church is superior to the Bible in the Roman Catholic theology. And on the second place is not the Bible, it is the tradition, because they go chronologically. Roman Catholic theologians are smart people. They say before there was Bible, there was tradition. And before there was tradition, there was church. Therefore, the tradition is superior to the Bible, and the church is superior to both the tradition and the Bible. So we have here a totally different position where, when it comes to the sources of authority. So they don't accept sola scriptura principle, of course. And this is the same for the Orthodox Church, Eastern Orthodox Churches. They don't have the Pope, they don't have the Holy Magisterium, but they have the tradition and the Bible. I come from that part of the world, and I can tell you that the tradition fully rules the Bible. If you go to my little village where I was born in Eastern Serbia, my neighbors, they know almost nothing about the Bible, but they have all kinds of festivals and all kinds of pagan traditions and so on. So the tradition rules the Bible. If you ask Mormons what is their source of authority, they have the Bible and the Book of Mormon. But they will tell you, if you speak a little bit longer, since the book Revelation to Joseph Smith by Angel Mormon was the latest one, it is superior to the Bible. But when it comes to Lutheran Church, for example, even Martin Luther, he came up with his hermeneutical principle, sola scriptura, but was he faithful to this? No, I can tell you no. We should eternally be grateful to Martin Luther for his courage, but on the other hand, he also believed that church councils, universal church council, like the Council of Nicaea, or something like Apostolic Creed from the second century, also should have authority. And he also believed that some good books also. It is true that he believed that the Bible has absolute authority and that these other authorities should depend on the Bible. But still, he firmly believed that church councils and even sometimes tradition should also be taken into consideration. What about Adventists? I'm giving you here just the background. We have here, you know, we may have here the problem also. Because if you listen to people speaking from the pulpits, if you ask them what is the source of authority for our belief, for our doctrines, for our creeds, usually people will tell you this is the Bible and Ellen White's writings. But this is not what we officially believe. I have to be, I'm brutally honest, there are people within Adventist Church, they firmly believe this. But if you read our documents, we believe that the only source of authority for what we believe is the Bible. We truly believe, like the so-called radical reformers, like Anabaptists, for example, that the Bible is the only source of authority for Seventh-day Adventist Church. Immediately you are going to raise the question, now, what about Ellen White's writings? Here is our position. And I have to tell you that the last time we as a church, as a global church, we took the position on the theological place of Ellen White's writings, It was after the Desmond Ford controversy. It was in 1980s. Since that time, there were many statements by the General Conference, but it was that at that time in 1982, it was August. It is called 10 Affirmations and 10 Denials. It was published in Ministry Magazine. And here is, I'm going to quote some of these positions. Our position is that the writings of Ellen White are as inspired as the Bible. We don't believe in the degrees of inspiration. Either the text is inspired or not inspired. We believe that Ellen White's writings have prophetic authority. But the role of Ellen White's writings is different from the Bible. The role of Ellen White's writings is, I'm quoting now one of the affirmations, the role of Ellen White's writings is to help us to better understand the Bible and to put it in practice. So, if there is ever a contradiction between the Bible and Ellen White's writings, we will always stick to the Bible. So we believe in the sola scriptura principle. Having said that, you are young people, you know, I'm 65 years old, but I was with the young people all my life. I was more than 30 years in the classrooms, different classrooms with the students. I also have to tell you that I firmly believe, had God not revealed himself to that young woman, sometimes we call Ellen White the weakest of the weak, because she was physically frail and she also did not have any formal education. So had God not revealed himself to Ellen White, the miracle of Seventh-day Adventist Church would not exist. So, although we believe that the only absolute source of authority for us is the Bible, we have to accept that Ellen White had a spiritual prophetic gift. But that gift, the role of that gift, was to help people to go back to the Bible, because many essential biblical truths have been forgotten for centuries. And this is what the church, this is what God was doing many times in church history. I have one problem to confess to you this afternoon. I have a little bit problem. I don't have problem with the spiritual gift of Ellen White. My problem, personal, is with the period from the end of the first century when Apostle John, who was the last living apostle, died. And the 19th century, I don't think that during that long period, there was no prophetic gift among Christian church. It was the former GC president, Jan Paulsen. He told me that he was participating in many dialogues with Lutherans, and they believed that Martin Luther had prophetic gift. We don't believe that, but whether there was some other prophet, I don't know about this. So for us, sola scriptura principle is extremely important. We believe that the Bible is the only ultimate source of authority for us. The second hermeneutical principle is tota scriptura. This one is must. I think concerning the first one, we more or less we agree. Here we are all not passing the test. Tota scriptura. Let me say a few words about this hermeneutical principle. It literally means the totality of scripture. We believe that although there are around 40 authors and, I don't know, 66 books in the Bible, we believe that behind these authors, behind different literary genre, behind different styles of writings, we believe that there is the so-called unity of scripture. This is the key theological word, unity of Scripture. Because if the same Holy Spirit inspired all these people, then it means that behind all these books, whether they're historical books, whether they're the so-called Haggadah, Halakha, all kinds of legal documents or narratives, prophetic books, gospels, epistles, behind all these different literary genres, there is the same Holy Spirit. If there is the same Holy Spirit, there must be a spiritual unity of the Scripture. Let me give you, I have to try to be very short because the time is passing, but let me give you at least a few examples. For example, the question of slavery. Was there slavery in the Old Testament? Yes, there was slavery in the Old Testament. Was this the will of God? There were some hints that some of the things that we find in the Old Testament were progressive when compared to other countries at that time, but still there was slavery. Is this the will of God? How are we going to know? The only way to know what is the will of God when it comes to the slavery, to apply Tota Scriptura principle. For example, I don't have time to go to this issue. We can teach this for the whole semester, but if you go to the totality of Scripture, when you come to the epistles of Paul, suddenly he said, if you are en Christo, if you are in Christ, there is no Jew or Gentile, Greek or I don't know. There is no male or female, no slave or free man. In Christ, all are the same. These words have been uttered when in the Roman Empire, for every one free man, there were four slaves. It was revolution. You know, to say, you know, in the society where everything rested on the cheap labor or free labor of the slaves, that if somebody becomes a Christian, no more free men or slaves. In Christ, everybody is the same. And then if you go to the epistle to Philemon, I'm in love with that epistle. There is a doctoral dissertation written by one of our fine scholars, Richard Lehmann from France. When I read his dissertation, I felt so much in love with this one chapter epistle. And you know, when Paul writes to Philemon and sending back Onesimus, and he says, receive him not anymore as a slave, but as a brother in Christ. If you have something against him, because his reward was the death by the heated iron, because all the slaves had the so-called charisma. It was seal done with the heated iron. But instead of behaving like this, Philemon was told by Paul to receive him as a brother in Christ, revolution. So if you want to know what is the biblical position on the issue of slavery, we have to apply Tota Scriptura. Otherwise, no light, just confusion. What about use of alcohol? Again, in the Old Testament, they did drink alcohol. But if you go to the Proverbs, for example, Solomon says, don't even look. Give wine to those who want to perish. At the end, it will bite you as a snake. So if you want to know what is the biblical position on alcohol, Tota Scriptura principle, only then we understand. And polygamy, for example. And so there are many issues in the Bible in the same. There was polygamy. And Jesus was saying that at the beginning it was not so, when he was asked what wife will be the wife of that man, since he was married several times. He said, at the beginning it was not so. Moses allowed you this because of the hardness of your heart. So here we find a principle that sometimes God allowed the things that he never wanted because of the hardness of human heart. human beings were not able to receive more light. Now, let me come to Ellen White's writings when it comes to tota scriptura principle, for example. There are many examples. I can use the examples that Claudius asked me to talk about, for example. If we talk about eating meat, Claudio sent me such difficult passages. I can tell you where Ellen White is saying that the last generation believers should not be eating meat. Okay. I still remember when I was studying in US at Andrews University, then there was a huge problem in South Korea, where people didn't want to give tithe to the church anymore because some pastors ate meat. And yes, these statements are very strong. And if you read only these statements, it is extremely. So we are usually speaking about the policy and principle. If you don't know what we are talking about, policy is something that is related to a specific time. Principle is something that is valid for everybody in all time, and so on and so on. Is vegetarianism a principle or policy? And you know that when you read some of these statements of Ellen White, it seems that it is a principle. But when you read totality of Ellen White's writings, then we get a totally different picture, tota scriptura. Then we see, for example, I have found something here, but I'm not going to read to you. If you want later, I'm going to tell you what it is all about. Even after Ellen White received the health reform message, she didn't always follow these rules, and people are offended by this. But they forget that it was 19th century, that Ellen White traveled on the horseback most of the time, by train, then horseback, while she was visiting church members. And they would come to visit Adventist families, and they would offer her what they had on their farm. There were no cheeseburgers, veggie burgers. And she was very practical. We know what is the ideal. Ideal is in Genesis 1 and 2. And if there is a choice, like we have in UK, for example, I don't think there is a huge excuse not to be vegetarian. Although for Ellen White, to be vegetarian does not mean a total abstinence from meat. Sometimes some people who ate meat from time to time, she is using the term vegetarian for them. But we cannot make this to be a principle. Why? If you go even to my little village today, where I was born in Serbia, you'll see that there are just a few Adventists today. If you tell them you can only eat vegetarian food, they go to the store to buy just some essentials. They still eat what they produce on their farms. I was speaking in Philippines a few years ago. We traveled and we were meeting ministers in different unions. Philippines is a huge place, thousands of islands. And many of our church members are very poor. We usually have these seminars for ministers at our universities because there are more than 1 million Adventists in the Philippines. And many students would come to me. For example, one of them came and said, every day I'm eating salty fish. I know that my kidneys will fail, but I have no choice. So if you apply and you say vegetarianism is a principle, it has to be applied everywhere, by everybody, at all time, it wouldn't be biblical, first of all, because Jesus did not. So we gather all the statements of Ellen White, including those relating to the ministers in the last times. And we try to see what are the principles coming from the totality of Ellen White's writings. And let me read this, what is the position of our church. So the first principle concerning food is do the best you can under circumstances that may be beyond your control. Do the best. So even Ellen White, as I said, she had to sometimes do what she could in these circumstances. Do the best you can. The second one, do not use anything hurtful, such as alcohol, tobacco, or drugs. Second principle, coming from the totality of Ellen White's writings. If somebody is writing, one more time, do the best you can under circumstances that may be beyond your control. Do not use anything hurtful, such as alcohol, tobacco. Then the third principle, use judiciously that which is helpful. Use self-control. So even the good food, this is the Ellen White's book, Temperance, of course. And then also coming from Ellen White's writings is the following principle. Do not mark out any precise line in diet that everyone must follow, because not everyone has the same physical needs or opportunities to find the best food. I was serving as a pastor, minister, for many years in different churches. And sometimes I had church members who had to use some meat from time to time. So that's why Ellen White knew for that. Do not mark out any precise line in diet that everyone must follow, because not everyone has the same physical needs or opportunities to find the best food. And then follow health practices to improve one's mind for spiritual purposes, not to earn God's acceptance. Some vegans believe that they are with one foot already in heaven. So do not practice this in order to gain salvation, but because when we have a healthy body, our mind can understand the will of God much better. So these are the principles which come from the totality of the writings of Ellen White. When it comes to vegetarianism, we can discuss other issues later because the time is 5:45. Let me mention a few more. At 6, we'll start questions and answers, and then we'll go maybe back to some of these issues. Sacra This is C, Sacra, C, Sacra Scriptura sui ipsius interpres. The scripture is its own interpreter. The scripture is its own interpreter. It means not everything in the Bible and in the writings of Ellen White is equally clear. There are difficult passages to be understood in the Bible as well as in the writings of Ellen White. I'll give you one example from the Bible, and then we'll go to the writings of Ellen White. You probably know that the most difficult experience of the Adventist Church after the Great Disappointment was the difficulty with Desmond Ford in 1980s. More than 160 ministers left the church. Are you with me, guys? More than 160 ministers. I think last year I was with my wife in Australia speaking there in one large church, and they told me that even more than 160 and thousands of church members left the church. Why? Basically because of one biblical passage. And I would like to remind you that theology may be a dangerous toy to play with. This I'm not going to read. If you write, maybe sometimes in the future we can discuss this. This is in Hebrews 6, 9, 18 and 19, 20, where Paul says that Jesus, when he ascended to heaven, he went behind the veil. And Desmond Ford said, here it is. When Jesus ascended to heaven, he immediately started the Day of Atonement ministry. Therefore, nothing happened in 1844. Adventist Church is not a prophetic movement and so on, and you know this. And this is one passage, Hebrews 6, 19 and 20. And at that time, when this all was happening, we did not have answer. Only later, when the church was under pressure, our theologians discovered another passage in Hebrews 10, 19 and 20. So Hebrews 6, 19 and 20, Hebrews 10, where we found some key Greek words which explained what happened when Jesus ascended to heaven in Anno Domini 31. Did he start the Day of Atonement, or did he inaugurated, dedicated, consecrated the heavenly sanctuary as it used to be done in the earthly sanctuary? So I'm just telling you, Sacra Scriptura sui.
Sorry, oh my God.
Am I doing something wrong?
No, I would like to ask everybody else to mute their mic.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, you see, one difficult biblical passage is explained by another. So Sacra Scriptura, the scripture is its own interpreter. This is the same with Ellen White's writings. Let me give you one example from Ellen White's writings. It was, I think, a year ago. There was a minister from Germany. He wrote to me. He says, there is a passage from Ellen White where she says that Lucifer repented for what he did against Jesus. And the question was, the biblical principle is, as long as there is repentance, there is forgiveness. Why God did not forgive Lucifer if he repented? Because Ellen White says that he repented. I can tell you that for 2 weeks, I think, I struggled in the same office where I'm sitting tonight, looking for an explanation. I did not know what to write back to this minister in Germany. Until one day I found another statement by Ellen White, where she says Lucifer repented in the same way as Judas repented. And when you, as I mentioned earlier, Judas, the repentance of Judas was not sincere repentance for what he did, but his repentance was in the sense that he was sorry for not succeeding. When he realized that Jesus is going to be arrested and crucified, he went back and he has thrown the money. So he did not betray Jesus because of money, but he had secret agenda. Probably he is going to bring Jesus against the wall where he wouldn't have any more. He could, because Judas knew that Jesus has supernatural powers. Why he's playing game with Romans? We want free Israel. We want Davidic kingdom here. So I'll put Jesus against the wall. And when Romans try to arrest him, he will show them who is he. When it did not happen, Judas went and out and hanged himself. So it was not a true repentance. Only then I understood what Ellen White meant when she said that Lucifer repented. So Sacra Scriptura sui ipsius interpres. So let me mention two more. Spiritualia spiritualiter, spiritualia spiritualiter examinatur. It means spiritualia spiritualiter examinatur. It means spiritual things must be spiritually examined. And this is from the Epistle to the Corinthians, where Paul speaks about four different men, pneumaticos, psychikos, sarkinos, and sarkikos. So four different categories of people. So if somebody wants to understand the will of God, he has to have the mind of Christ. This is what Paul says, that the spiritual man understands the will of God. So I think I was teaching here for years at Newbold, one class to the postgraduate students, issues and trends in contemporary theology. And in this class, I'm speaking also about Karl Barth, the greatest theologian of the 20th century. When he speaks about people approaching the Bible, he says that, I'm not able to quote exactly, but he says that we should approach the Bible with open spiritual eyes, with the heart ready to obey, and so on and so on. So spiritual things should be spiritually discerned. I can speak for a long time. This is very important principle. And just let me tell you, young people, from my experience serving as a pastor for many years, I did not have many problems with non-Adventists coming to Adventist church when it comes to Ellen White's writings. Usually, children born in the church, they usually don't read Ellen White's writings. They know very little about them, but they find on internet something, and then they are very eager to share this. When people come from the outside of the church, I usually ask them to read the Gospel of John, then other Gospels, maybe I'm in love with the book of Job, and so on and so on. Then I give them Steps to Christ or Messiah or Desire of Ages or Great Controversy. In most cases, these non-Adventists, they come back and they said, there is something special in these books. There is something special in these books. But when it comes to our people, they reject Ellen White's writings a priori. Maybe some of us have lost spiritualia spiritualiter examinatur. Spiritual things must be spiritually examined. And the fifth one, this is German, this was Latin, all of these four. And the last one is German. And this is how it is used in theology. Sitz, S-I-T-Z, im Leben. It means sit in the life. Or the word we are using here is historical context. Whenever, I think, as far as I'm concerned, all these hermeneutical principles are important. But probably the second one for Adventists and this one are the most important. Whenever we speak about the Bible, and whenever you stand behind the pulpit and you want to say something, it is not difficult today. Everything is online. Try to find the historical context. When it was said, to whom it was addressed, what were the historical circumstances when it was said, and so on and so on and so on. Sitz im Leben, I can go to you from one example to another, where it is clear, if we do not know the historical context, we are not able to understand the scripture. The classical example for me is the parable of Jesus in the Gospel of Luke chapter 16, the parable of the shrewd manager. If you read this parable, then suddenly you find that the master is telling nice things about the thief, and not only he's commending him, but he's inviting us to follow him. God inviting us to follow a thief. And it seems when we read the parable and the rest of the text that those who listened, they understood very well, because there is a gap of 2,000 years between us and the time when the text was written, and they understood. And when we somehow rediscover the historical context, suddenly that parable becomes extremely valuable. I remember I did my BA in France at Collonge, and when I found out what is the meaning of that parable, suddenly I felt as the sky was opened. Historical context, extremely important. Suddenly everything was in its place, you know. And when it comes to Ellen White, this is the same thing. Ellen White is the 19th century person. And of course, there are some councils which belong to that category. But still, is it still the word of God? Yes. Let me give you classical examples. For example, the girls should learn how to harness and to ride horses. And it seems it was a good counsel at that time. The girls should know how to ride and harness the horses. But this is 19th century. Is it still the word of God? Yes, it is. But the times have changed. Maybe she would tell to the boys and girls even today that they should not sit all the time in front of these screens, but they should be able to do some practical work and to face the challenges of contemporary life, to know how to drive the car, to know some. So it is still the word of God, but we should know the historical context. I can give you another, many examples like this. For example, Ellen White said that children should not go to school before they are aged 8 or 9 years. So only after 9 years, according to Ellen White, the children should go to school. Why? Because she wanted the children to spend more time with their parents and in nature and so on and so on. And there was a hospital in St. Helena in California, and many of our church members worked at that hospital. There were no nurseries at that time. They could not leave their children with their parents and so on and so on. So they would come to work and their children were running outside of the hospital or sometimes through the corridors. And there was an older sister there, nurse. And she said one day, I'm going to gather these children and teach them something from the Bible. And this is what she did. But some older people said, no. The prophet has said, nobody should teach the children except their parents and nature until they reach 8 or 9 years. And they didn't stop there. They invited the old lady to the church board. They wanted to discipline her. And then somebody said, but the prophet lived just a few blocks. Let's invite Ellen White to the church board. And this is what they did. She was already very old. And Ellen White came to the church board. And they kept talking one after another. Yes, in your books you have given us counsels and we have followed this and obeyed. And she was listening. And then at one point she said, brethren, use your common sense and sanctified reason. I'm quoting now. Use your common sense and sanctified reason. She said, yes, this is an ideal that parents should spend more time with their children before they start going to school, because once they start going, they are never back, as you know. But this is an ideal situation. But this sister didn't do anything wrong. It's much better to gather these kids and teach them. So use your common sense and sanctified reason. And this is, I think, extremely important. I'm going to stop here. It is 6 o'clock. And I think Claudio is going to lead now the discussion, questions and answers period. And
thank you very much, Rabbi, for this great insight we got. So I took these notes: sola scriptura, tota scriptura, sacra scriptura, so the scripture interprets itself, spiritual things should be understood spiritually, and sitz im Leben, which is the context. I know them from Newbold, but you know, it was a good reminder today. Now the floor is open for questions. What I would like you to ask is, when you ask a question, switch on the video so we can see you. And I know some of you have already some questions, but if you are watching this program online on the YouTube link, please write your question on the YouTube comments, and I'll pick it up from there, and I will ask Dr. Antic about it. So the floor is open to the questions.
So I'll start off from this representing Irvin Church. It was how to differentiate between the advice that is and is not applicable today.
So in Adventist Church, we are, as I mentioned already, we are making the difference between the policy and the principle. How do we know what is applicable and what is not applicable? This is a very good question. I think Ellen White, I think even I read sometimes the position of, for example, one of the best books that was written on Ellen White and hermeneutics is written by Herbert Douglas, The Messenger of the Lord. So I can even show you. Give me that. No. So this is the book, The Messenger of the Lord. Here, this is a classical book which is used as a textbook in Adventist colleges around the world. But the most recent book, written on Ellen White, where we have the most recent information concerning Ellen White, is in this book, The Gift of Prophecy. And it was published just, I think, a year or two ago. And Adventist best theologians have written different key articles in this book, The Gift of Prophecy. Indeed, to come back to your question, Adrian, the answer is, how do we know what is applicable today? Common sense and sanctified reason. I would not be extremely radical here and to tell you, we should have common sense, but not only common sense. It may be, but listen to Ellen, common sense and sanctified reason. This is interesting.
Thank you. Another question that we had, I've got a couple written down, but I also want to give the chance to others to say, but before I do that, I'm just going to say another one. How much of Ellen G. White's writings are inspired directly from God, and some, and how much is of her own accord? So how much do you reckon she wrote by herself?
Okay, so the same question may be asked for the Bible itself. So before I come to, so this is the question which is called the question of revelation and inspiration. How inspiration works. I can speak for another hour about that, but I'll summarize. And this is extremely important, the question that you ask. There are different theories of inspiration, of course. There is the so-called natural theory of inspiration, according to which the Bible is written just by geniuses, like Mozart was genius in the field of music. I don't know. We have in different fields, in literature, we have Shakespeare. So we have, as we have geniuses in other fields, we also have geniuses in the field of religion. So the Bible, with such success in human history, is written by religious geniuses, but there is nothing supernatural there. We reject this theory, and there is no problem there at all. The second one, which is related to your question, is the partial theory of inspiration. According to this partial theory of inspiration, some parts of the Bible are inspired and others are not. And we have already in Luther partially this partial theory of inspiration. And we have Karl Barth was using this. And Luther, for example, maybe you know, maybe you don't, Luther didn't like all the biblical books. He didn't like, for example, the epistle of James. He called this epistle the epistle of straw. Why? Because it speaks about the justification or importance of the good works, if you want. Luther's principle was in German, was zum Christus trieb, what leads to Christ. This was him. Only those passages in the Bible which lead to Christ, they are the word of God. Other passages are not the word of God. Or, for example, Karl Barth, that I mentioned earlier, he was saying, he's in Calvinist tradition, Reformed tradition, but he also said something interesting. He said, the Bible is not the word of God, but the word of God is in the Bible. It also leads to the partial theory of inspiration. The Bible is not the word of God, but the word of God is in the Bible. And he also believed in that principle, was sum Christus trib, what leads to Christ. We reject this theory. Why? Because it is not biblical. When Paul writes to Timothy, he says, passa graphe theo pneustos. All the scriptures are God-breathed. So this is interesting. When God created man, he breathed into his nostrils nishmat haim, or the breath of life. In the same way, Paul is using this analogy, because he knew Hebrew writings. He's using the same principle. And he says, when God inspires his word, he breathes life. And Paul says, all scripture is inspired by God. Now, just to make one step further and to say, maybe this question is somehow backed by the so-called verbal inspiration of the Bible, verbal. And we have problems with this one. This theory is called mechanical inspiration, according to which the biblical prophet is the passive instrument. There, in the Middle Ages, there were some paintings where the prophet is sitting holding a big feather, and behind him is an angel whispering to his ear what to write. This is called verbal theory of inspiration. And many of our church members have this. They believe in verbal theory of inspiration. And your question behind that question may be this baggage. What do we believe? What is the inspiration? We believe in the so-called organic theory of inspiration, not organic in the sense of organic food, but in the sense of totality of the prophet is inspired. What does it mean? It means the prophet's mental capacities, his physical health, his education, his family, his time, his city in which he lived, all of this contributed to the inspiration. We do not believe in the word inspiration, word, but we believe in the thought inspiration. What does it mean? It means that we believe that absolute truths are found in the Bible, but they are not found in isolated words, but in the thoughts behind these words. For example, in the Bible, there is sentence saying there is no God. You know this. But then before that, you have that a fool man said in his heart, there is no God. When we are talking about thought inspiration, let me give you some example. What do we have in mind when we are talking about thought inspiration? So let's say Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. Let's just bring these first three verses. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He leads me to the green pastures. He leads me to the still waters. He leads me on the paths of righteousness. He restores my soul, and so on and so on. What I have been doing, when we do exegesis of the Bible text, we are analyzing the key words, shepherd, green pastures, still waters, paths of righteousness. He restores my soul. If we take these words isolation, green pastures, it wouldn't tell anything. But if we put these words together, shepherd, green pastures, still waters, he's restoring my soul, then suddenly we get an idea who God is. This is thought inspiration. The word of God in these first three verses is that God is caring God. He gives everything for his flock. He's risking even his own life, and so on and so on and so on. The same is with Ellen White's writings. To come back to your question, what is inspired? What comes from Ellen White personally? Now, not everything is what Ellen White wrote comes from the direct from God. Of course, she says, I may find this for you. Maybe it would be useful if I can find this. To quote, just 1 second, please. Here is what she says. When I do the things the Lord gives me to do, then I can endure the strain. When I step out of the channel he has given to me, I'm not sustained. So she says that there is an option to be out of the step, out of the channel, out of the channel, and so on and so on. And she also says that she did some wrong things. One brother wrote to her, and she said, listen to this. He said, sorry, this is the quote, I was led to conclude and most firmly believe that every word that you ever spoke in public or private, that every letter you wrote under any and all circumstances was as inspired as the Ten Commandments. She wrote back to that man and said, my brother, you have studied my writings diligently and you never found that I have made any such claim. And so on and so on. I think this is not now. So yes, she rejected this. And here is now the most important quote. She says, there are times when common things must be stated. Common thoughts must occupy the mind. Common letters must be written and information given that has passed from one to another of our workers. Such words, such inspiration are not given under the special inspiration of the Spirit of God. So Ellen White was a mother. She has two of her sons died. At that time, there was no email. She wrote letters. And she says there are times when common things must be stated. Common thoughts must occupy the mind, and common letters must be written. Ellen White was not 24-hour-a-day prophet. She did make some mistakes. But when we see Ellen White, we say, ho, 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 here it is. She made. But what about Prophet David, brothers and sisters? Did he make some mistakes? What about Prophet Samuel when he came to anoint the future king of Israel? And when he came to the house of Jesse, and when he saw the first son, he said, this is the future king of Israel. Was he right? No, he was wrong. What about Prophet Nathan, who was the court prophet of King David? when he went to King David, and David says, I want to build a sanctuary, and Nathan says, go ahead. But only when he went home, the Lord said, no, David cannot build the sanctuary. His hands are full of blood. He comes back to David. And, was he right first time? No, he was wrong. So biblical prophets are not 24 hours a day prophets. They were people living in their time. And Ellen White herself says that there are common letters to be written. There are common things to occupy the mind and so on and so on. And then to come back again to your question, then how do we know what is common and what is the word of God? The only solution is tota scriptura. We take the totality of the writings on certain issue and we look for the principles there which can be applied everywhere to everybody in all time. This is proper hermeneutics is the only way, because Ellen White wrote extensively. And it is not easy if we take just some parts of her writings and then we neglect other parts. We have, for example, let me come back to the Bible, narratives in the Old Testament, where the political situation in ancient Israel was described. Is it the word of God? Narratives? But more and more theologians believe that even in the narratives, we have the moral, ethical issues, and not only in the Ten Commandments. So I believe we have to take the totality of Ellen White's writings and look for the principles which can be applied everywhere to everybody.
Thank you very much, Radisha. I've got a question in from Edinburgh. I'll be reading this since it's quite a long passage. And it says, there are many, many good things in Ellen White's writings that are not prophecy, nor related to final events. And I don't have questions about how God used her marvelously to teach me so many lessons in that. I am not a fanatic about prophecy, nor am I worried about last day events. I study it because I think it's important to know what is revealed. However, previous Scottish Mission sessions on how to understand the Bible made me rethink about what I can learn from Ellen White regarding final events and prophecy. How to identify in Ellen G. writings what conditional and unconditional prophecies, as well as her own interpretation of scriptures, are. I recently heard, just as an example, that Sunday law is an understand about Revelation 13 and that it may not come to happen. It then came to me as something we have expected, but this understanding is also subjected to change. Even though she dispels any doubts in this matter, at least in my understanding, and I may be wrong, that's why I'm asking.
Thank you so much. I think this is a very good question, very good question. Usually when we say the word prophet, we have in mind predicting future, but this is not the case in the Bible. This is one of the roles of the prophets. Prophet is primarily somebody who speaks in the name of God. It does not mean necessarily that he or she are predicting the future. In Ellen White's writings, about 1% of her writings is predicting the future. And as the brother who wrote this, he noticed there are some conditional and unconditional prophecies concerning, for example, some of the prophecies. I noticed, especially when it comes to Ellen White, when I read what she wrote about skyscrapers in New York, it is. And when I watched TV, I think I don't remember when I was, but I was in some hotel somewhere in the world, when it happened, 9/11, you remember. And when you read Ellen White's writings about these huge buildings in New York, Chicago, and when you look what happened really, I don't know, you know, this is, for example, let me read just part of this. On one occasion when in New York City, I was in the night season called upon to behold buildings rising story after story towards heaven. These buildings were warranted to be fireproof, and they were erected to glorify their owners and builders. Higher and still higher, these buildings rose, and in them the most costly material were used. As these lofty buildings went up, the owners rejoiced with ambitious pride that they had money to use in gratifying and provoking the envy of their neighbors. The scene that has passed before me was an alarm of fire. And if you watched, and you, I think you have all watched, you know, firemen played a huge role. The scene that next passed before me was an alarm of fire. Men looked at the lofty and supposedly fireproof buildings and said, they are perfectly safe, but these buildings were consumed as if made of pitch. The fire engines could do nothing to stay the destruction. The firemen were unable to operate the engines. So, for example, this prophecy is extremely interesting to me. When it comes to the Sunday law, to come closer to what you read, this is interesting one, because I think I have it somewhere here. I was, for example, in Japan a few years ago. We were also speaking to the ministers there. And yes, there were around 160 ministers from all the country of Japan. And they raised this issue, the same issue, you know. It seems when Ellen White speaks about the Sunday law, that she speaks universally, that it is going to happen everywhere. And the brethren in Japan raised this issue because they don't have this issue at all, because the religion is totally different. This is Shinto religion and Buddhist religion. And Sunday law is not at all even discussed. It is discussed here in the European Union and in the United States, but not everywhere. Now, is it universal? Yes, Ellen White draws this from the Bible, because Revelation 13 speaks about the mark of the beast and about the Sunday law and so on and so on and so on. But when we read how it was understood, for example, I have here the copy from the grandson of Ellen White, who was for many years the director of Ellen White Estate. He said, Ellen White's statements, which are there collected in the last day events, pages 134, 138, clearly speak of the controversy involving every country of the globe, although apparently centered in the Christian world. So I have no ultimate answer here. Whether the issue of Sunday law, because there were attempts at the time when in the 19th century, when Ellen White was alive, there were attempts in the United States to establish the Sunday law. Under that, it is quite possible, and using our interpretation of Revelation 13, that it seemed that this is going to happen in the whole world. I really do, nobody knows whether it is going to happen in the whole world. Maybe it will, who knows? When I read these post-COVID predictions of some of the serious authors, it seems that the world is going to unite more and more to fight, to struggle against the future pandemia and the different crises. So who knows, maybe it will happen, or maybe it will happen partially. I think we do not have full light on this issue. Arthur White seems to be inclined to have in mind the Christian world primarily.
Thank you very much.
Lucas, are you ready with your questions?
Sorry, yes. So we have some questions here from the youth of Edinburgh. Some of the questions you have already answered, like the first question was about like if all her writings were prophetic or non-inspired, something like you did that already. So the next one is, Ellen White wrote that coffee drinking is a sin. It is written in CD, I don't know the name of the book, CD 425.3 is the reference. So, and then go on. So, of course, there are many other things that we consume daily that are worse than coffee, junk food, and etc. But this is a direct statement. Was it related to the way it was processed at her time, or it's just something neglected? What is the understanding of the church today?
Yes. Lucas, unfortunately, I have to tell you that many Adventists drink coffee today. You probably know this. I'm not telling you anything new. And there are also many others who do not drink the coffee. I traveled for years for some meetings to California, to Loma Linda, and we were presented many cases where most of heart attacks and the strokes happened, according to some research in California, in the morning when people drink coffee. Apparently coffee somehow brings some tension to the blood vessels and so on and so on. I think there are many, many evidences today that coffee is not as healthy as it looks to be. And my opinion is that we should be avoiding coffee. But when it, and of course, how to interpret the sentence that you just read, we should not take this one when it comes to the food and drinks to one, we should not take one word or sentence, but take the totality of her statements on the health and healthy food, and then only come to the conclusion. My position is negative, but I know people within the church who cannot live without the coffee. Coffee creates kind of dependence, you know, like drugs and so on and so on. So in that sense, but whether it is the ultimate sin, I wouldn't say this, you know. But although the Bible says that we should not, probably Ellen White is biblical. She draws this from when Paul says, if somebody is destroying his body, God will destroy him. So in that sense, if we do something against, consciously against our body, then we are sinning in this way. But I think food and committing the sin, these are two different things, but I think even that statement should be understood in the wider context on related to the principles I mentioned earlier.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lucas.
I have just one more question, and I think you have partially answered that in your previous answer as well. So I'm just going to read it quickly. When it comes to her writings related to final events, should we study them and expect them to happen, or it was just a message for her time? For example, the news have recently reported that Chinese economy is to overtake the US by 2028. It's from BBC 2020, last year. Hypothetically speaking, if I had to make investments Should I trust what Ellen White says and keep believing that the US will continue to be the leading nation, or should I have an open mind to new possibilities?
Oh, very good. When it comes to eschatology, and this is the last day events, I would very openly warn you that no serious theologian within Adventist Church, and even more outside of the Adventist Church, will come to you and tell you exactly the sequence of events of the last days. Are you with me? Mm-hmm. Have you heard me well what I said?
Yes.
No serious theologian, the one who is doing honestly, will come you. You know, you are, many of you are very young, but Paul Tompkins is here. Whether you believe or not, we played soccer, football together for Newbold against London bus drivers.
And who won?
I don't remember who won. Or maybe you remember, Paul. I don't remember.
That must not have been a good season.
So there were many people in Adventist Church, and you know some of them, who have made these charts, you know, and they know exactly, and they predicted the date when Jesus is going to come. This is not biblical. And we should be very careful with all these predictions. I think we should be ready, as if Jesus is going to come tonight. We should do our best. We should not be scared. We should have confidence in God, and have peace in our mind, which comes from God himself. But when it comes to the exact sequence of events, who is going to be the economic power of the world? Is it going to be the China or the United States? It is difficult to say. Probably, you know, if I was in China, China is a great country, but still, you know, if you walk through the Shanghai, the buildings are huge, it looks nice, but if you go a little bit to the left and to the right, this is not so nice. So I don't think our theology should be led by a daily news and politics. We should have a general trust in God, and we should know that God is leading this history towards the end. And leave these details to God. I wouldn't go into the details.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Thank you very much.
There's another question from Irvin Church on Ellen White's point of view regarding vaccines.
Yes. Yes, there are some statements where Ellen White urged people, and this Claudio who pressed me to speak on this, because he kept sending me these quotes. And when I read them and reread them yesterday, it seemed to me that I can understand what Ellen White is saying. She says that first of all, we should try to live good lives, healthy lives, to take care of our hygiene, to take care of our immune system. And there are also statements where she says that immunization or vaccination has helped some people. But she speaks that when we are vaccinated, then our body is given some weakened viruses or whatever. And she was right there. So when it comes to this, you know, the position, I don't know whether you saw the position of our church. I think they have taken into the statements of Ellen White in their totality. And I'm going to read to you the statement, the position of our church. Here it is. The Seventh-day Adventist Church places strong emphasis on health and well-being. The Adventist health emphasis is based on biblical revelation, the inspired writings of Ellen White. As such, we encourage responsible immunization, vaccination, and have no religious or faith-based reason not to encourage our members to responsibly participate in protective and preventive immunization programs. We value the health and safety of the population, which includes the maintenance of herd community. We are not the conscience of every individual church member and recognize individual choices. These are exercised by the individual. The choice not to be immunized is not and should not be seen as dogma, nor the doctrine of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I believe that this position is very well balanced. So if somebody within the church feels that he or she, they don't want to be vaccinated, then this is their choice. But generally speaking, the totality of Ellen White's writings, of course we agree with Ellen White that it is the best to keep good hygiene, to have good immune system, sunshine, clean air, and so on and so on. This is the best thing, of course. But if somebody comes to the point where the life is in danger, then of course our church is inviting people to be vaccinated. This is the position of our church. I would also, I don't know whether you know this book. This is the Ellen White's Encyclopedia. It is a thick book, you see. But if some of you are preaching in the church, although you are not ministers, and you have to, you are faced with different questions, this is a very useful work. So Ellen White Encyclopedia, this is a recent book. And maybe the president of Scottish Mission can buy this for each minister and make a gift. So this would be very good, you know. A real gift.
I second that.
Thank you. Thank you, Rabbi. Any other questions from the floor?
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please. But can we see you?
Yeah. But I'm just holding my phone, so it'll be a bit difficult to ask. So I'm just asking a question based on one of Ellen White's writings, and I think it comes from Desire of Ages, and it says, "Had the Church of Christ done her appointed work as the Lord ordained, the whole world would before this have been warned, and the Lord Jesus would have come to the earth in power and great glory." So with this quote, obviously, like, I don't necessarily have a stand on this quote myself per se, but obviously, looking at different pastors' sermons, reading around, there's this divide within the church that we can hasten or we cannot hasten the coming of Christ. And obviously, based on some of Ellen White's writings, and then she writes, I think, Testimonies to the Church, where, or Selected Messages, one of the two, where she said that, you know, the day of Christ's coming was revealed to her in vision, but when she came out of vision, she totally forgot about it, and she doesn't know when Christ is going to come. So these are all different quotes, and she does constantly quote that, you know, we have to work. If the work was done, then Christ would have come. And she does, I think, also in Desire of Ages, where she says that Christ would have come at this time. And I think she was, I don't know whether she was talking about 1844, but she does write saying that Christ would have come at this time if the people had done the work they were supposed to do. So what's your take on these particular quotes from Ellen White? And should we take them as they are? And what's the church's stand on whether we can or cannot hasten the coming of Christ?
Thank you so much, Chloe. Thank you. I almost forgot that Claudio also raised this issue with me. Yes, in the Bible, if we go to Peter's epistle, um, there is a passage which says, this is Second Peter chapter 3, verse 11 and 12. It says, since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to be holy and godly lives. As you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. So this is the word, or hasten its coming. Speed the coming of the Lord. So it seems, and I checked the Greek word, speudontas, and the word really means hastening. But it also may mean waiting and desiring earnestly. So it is that this is some also serious theologians are using this. It may mean hastening, speeding up, or waiting and desiring earnestly. And then this is one side of the story, and this is how we do theology. Let me read other passages. The second passage is found in Matthew 24. And you know this by heart. Verse 14, the text says, and this gospel of kingdom will be preached into the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and the end will come. And the end will come. Okay. And then, this is one side of the story. We preach the gospel. We are mission-oriented church. We can hasten the second coming. This is how it looks like when we read these passages. But then, when we read some other passages, for example, in the Gospel of in the book of Acts, chapter 17. In the book of Acts, chapter 17. It says that, just 1 second, I'll tell you the verse. The text says, verse 31, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. So here, Paul, speaking to Epicurean and Stoic philosophers, he says that Jesus has set a day. Then there is another passage in the Gospels when Jesus says, nobody knows the day of the coming of the second coming except the Father. So Jesus himself is stating that Father knows the day. Paul says God has set the day of the second coming. If God has set the day of the second coming, how then we can hasten the second coming? So there is some tension here between these passages. Both cannot be true. If something is set, and if God already knows, and you know in the Bible when God knows the day, then it is a fact, it is already like an experience, then how we can hasten the second coming? Because of that, I have also analyzed Matthew 24. And then we will preach the gospel and then the end will come. But it is, after some other passages, it also says, and then the end will come. If we take generally the biblical revelation, now we come back to the tota scriptura, then some people believe when the people of God will reach certain perfection, then God will come. Even Ellen White disagrees with that. Yes, she made some statements that you just, Adrian has mentioned. She did make statements, have been done, Jesus would have come. But you know, even apostles expected Jesus to come during their lifetime. Is it true? Yes, it is. In that sense, if we take a systematic approach, tota scriptura approach, it seems that the biblical position is that if ever, we rely on human justice and human perfection and human missionary activities in order to hasten the second coming, it will never happen. Never. Never. Should we then work in the field? It is my deep privilege. I think Paul and I, we studied together here at Newbold. I hope I'll retire this year. And I've been working for the church for almost 40 years now. I can tell you, it was such a privilege for me. It was such a joy. I believe to be a minister is the greatest privilege for any human being. Why? Because I don't want to put down any other profession, to be a medical doctor or to be an engineer or to be the farmer. All these professions are equally important. But what a joy to work in the field of the Lord. This is an advantage for human being. This is such a privilege for human being to work in the vineyard of the Lord. We should not take this advantage, this privilege that God has given to us as a kind of debt, something that we do, then we deserve, and we can hasten the second coming. I know that many people in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, even some people on the high positions, firmly believe in this hastening of the second coming. I believe it is theologically totally wrong, because God is a sovereign God. Everything remains on his decision. He is leading human history. And he will have the final say. He has set the day when he will judge the world. Our participation in the vineyard is a great grace for human beings. It is God's mercy. For that reason, I would translate the passage from the Second Peter in the sense of eagerly desiring, eagerly waiting for the second coming.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Because for me, literally, it wouldn't make so much sense if God knows the day he's coming, but then we have almost like a power in us to almost change his mind, because that's what it may look like. But then I've also heard other pastors saying that promise is a conditional promise, based on the condition that we have to preach the gospel and then Christ will come back sooner. And there's also somewhere where Ellen writes, I've forgotten exactly where, because I was just reading through, where she does say that, you know, Christ's coming is best, it's basically a conditional promise, that, you know, we do the work and then Christ will come. So of course it doesn't make sense to me, like genuinely, like we as human beings, Christ coming is not based on our works. And if the day is set, then how would we hasten his coming? But how would you exactly respond to people that would say that promise is conditional?
We have to take the general teaching of the Bible. I would not say it is conditional. Of course, we are invited to live a holy lives. And this is, the Bible is full of doing good works. Even the epistle to the Romans and the epistle to the Galatians is inviting us to live a holy life. Ellen White, in all her writings, is inviting this. But when it comes to soteriology, to the salvation itself, it is clear in Ellen White's writings and in the Bible that all our righteousness, all our good works can never be the cause of our salvation, but only the consequence of being saved. So in that sense, I think this is, whether it is conditional, I wouldn't enter into this. It doesn't seem to me theological enough when it comes to the second coming of Jesus and the righteousness of human beings. And I don't really believe, one sister told me a few years ago in London, I have been sinless for the last six months. I think she does not understand what sin is really is. But thank you, Chloe, for your remarks. It was very good.
Thank you. We still have 8 minutes, so maybe we can take one or two questions. I saw a question on the chat that says, Dr. Andy, you mentioned about denials about Ellen White's writings. What are those denials?
Of course, many, when I say denials, I have in mind all those people rejecting Ellen White's writings altogether. And there are many such people in Argentina.
No, I think it's with regards to that article you mentioned in Ministries.
Oh. Okay. Here it is. This is, you cannot see, but maybe if you want to find, if you are a minister, this is published in Ministry Magazine, 1982. Ministry Magazine. Ministry Magazine, 1980, August. And it is called The Inspiration and Authority of Ellen G. White Writings, A Statement of Present Understanding as Revised. And here you have 10 affirmations and 10 denials. In my view, this is the best that we produced as a church in our history. And some, I can read some of them to you. So this is the clear statement. What is our position on Ellen White's writings? For example, let me read some of them. First affirmation, we believe that scripture is divinely revealed word of God and is inspired by the Holy Spirit. So this is, the Bible is the ultimate source of authority for us. We believe that scripture is the divinely revealed word of God. The second affirmation, we believe that the canon of scripture is only composed of 66 books of the Old and New Testament. You know, some people wanted to add Ellen White's books to the canon of the scripture. That's why we have this affirmation. We believe that the canon of scripture is composed only of 66 books of the Old and New Testament. Affirmation number three, we believe that scripture is the foundation of faith and the final authority in all matters of doctrine and practice. Very important statement. We believe that scripture is the foundation of faith and the final authority in all matters of doctrine and practice. Affirmation number four, we believe that scripture is the word of God in human language. Of course, the Bible was not written in some heavenly language. It is human language, human words. And Ellen White says, whatever is human is not perfect. So in the Bible also we have some mistakes and so on and so on and so on. I can show you, like in the writings of Ellen White, but still we have absolute truths expressed in the thoughts. Then we believe that the ministry and writings of Ellen White were manifestations of the gift of prophecy. And then, for example, eight, I'm not going to read all of them. We believe that the purpose of Ellen White writings include guidance, and I mentioned this to you earlier. Guidance, what is the role of Ellen White? Guidance in understanding the teaching of scripture and application of those teachings with prophetic urgency to the spiritual and moral life. Yes. You may also ask, is the acceptance of Ellen White's writings when somebody is baptized, is it, how do we say, help me,
a condition of acceptance into the fellowship of Seventh-day Adventist Church, isn't it?
But there is another word that we usually use. Somehow it is slipping.
Requirement?
Profession of faith? Profession of faith?
No, profession. Okay, never mind. But you understand. No, it is not. The acceptance of Ellen White's writings is not. If somebody in your church tomorrow says, I do not believe in Ellen White's writings, you cannot disfellowship him or her. It is not a condition to be the member of the church. Let me read to you. And I know what I'm talking. I'm not teaching you a heresy. Please trust me on this one. I checked this many times with the people in the General Conference. Listen to this. This is affirmation number 9. We believe that the acceptance of the prophetic gift of Ellen White, while not a requirement for continuing church membership, is important to the nurture and unity of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Yes. Well, for example, a few years ago, we had a Pentecostal woman. She came to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. She was already baptized by immersion in Pentecostal church. She wanted to become the church of member of the Adventist Church, but she could not somehow accept a prophetic gift of Ellen White. The church board wrote to me and they explained that she even is selling her books on the street, Ellen White's books, but she does not believe that she was a prophet. What shall we do? Was the letter from the church board. I wrote back to them telling them that they should accept her, even they don't need to baptize her again, because she was already baptized in the Pentecostal church by immersion. So in that sense, this is interesting. This is here. And then we have 10 denials. If this is the opposite of affirmations, and so on and so on. I don't want to read all of this, but this is basically we do not believe that the writings of Ellen White serve the same purpose as does scripture. So we believe that scripture and Ellen White's writings have different purpose. That scripture, which is the sole foundation and the final authority of Christian faith, we do not believe that the writings of Ellen White are an addition to the canon of the scripture. We do not believe that scripture can be understood only through the writings of Ellen White. This was endlessly discussed I was member of the Biblical Research Institute of the General Conference for many years, and we have been discussing this. When Ellen White writes about certain passage from the Bible, when she says about this passage something, does this mean that what she says that the Bible says, is it the only meaning of scripture? Do the writings of Ellen White exhaust the meaning of the scripture? No, we do not believe this. We believe that that text, in addition to what Ellen White says, may also mean something else. So I think this is an important document. Yes.
We are now exhausting the 2 hours. I just give the last chance for a pressing question, otherwise I would close here. Anybody who'd like to ask a question right now? Or
I would like to ask a question. Can you see me?
Yes.
So my question is in relation to, I know there's in terms of, in addition to the hastening of the second coming of Christ, I know there is this movement about fleeing from the cities and running to the hills. And obviously it comes from Ellen White's writings where she does says out of the cities. But what's your standpoint on that? Can you add some clarification or some extra depth into what she meant when she wrote that?
Thank you, Benjamin. Very important question, very important question. I think 2 years ago or something like this, I received a phone call from the pastor in Newcastle, And my wife and I, we traveled on Saturday morning. It was, I think, 5 hours drive. And the pastor was so, I don't remember his name. Paul probably knows him. It was Friday conversation. You have to come. We have a fire in the church. Some church members, they want to leave Newcastle and England altogether. They want to go back to Africa. And
come to Scotland.
And their children didn't want to follow them. So the whole families are in huge problems. So we went there and we discussed. And I found that church very nice church, international church. There are people from different parts of the world. And here is Benjamin, the biblical and Ellen White's evidences. Here, I'm convinced 100% what I'm saying. And when it was the Sunday law, I have some reservations concerning the international, but here how the things, because I did thorough research here. Yes, there is a statement, and I have it here somewhere, the whole paper on this. There is a statement by Ellen White where she says, then when we see the Sunday law established, then it will be the final sign to leave the cities and to go to some secluded places. This is, it seems, one quote. And then when I did research, I found tens and tens of quotes where Ellen White says, we should go to the cities, establish schools, publishing houses, restaurants. You have one statement, go out, and then you have tens and tens statements saying, we should go where the people are. Establish schools, restaurants, publishing houses, and serve the people in the cities. So, hermeneutics, tota scriptura. Of course we know what is ideal living. This is in Genesis, this is Garden of Eden. Of course we know that living in the city is not the perfect condition. We all would like to live somewhere outside, and this is the best place. On the other hand, if we all leave the cities where people live today, the majority, large majority, what will happen? Then I read, I have here in front of me, I have passages from the Gospels about Jesus. And Jesus, it says, he went from one town to another. From one town to another. Then Jesus said, go into all the world, not only to the secluded places. Go into all the world. And in that sense, for example, Arthur White, the grandson of Ellen White, says, the emergency flight to the mountains will be made when our nation makes a decree enforcing papal Sabbath. So you see, this is the direct quote. Even Arthur White believed that this Sunday law will be, he says, our nation, the United States. When the United States will proclaim this Sunday law, it will be the sign. But on the other hand, we have to keep in mind that Ellen White kept emphasizing the work in the cities. And we have to take a balanced approach here. Of course, we know it is the best thing to live somewhere outside. But then many more invitations, many more calls to the church members come from Ellen White, inviting them to go to the cities and to share the gospel there. So all these brethren, this is one-sided biblical exegesis. It is not faithful interpretation of the scripture. It is simply not only of the scripture, it is not faithful representation of what is in Ellen White's writings. It is simply misusing Ellen White's writings.
Yeah, thank you for that. Thank you.
Thank you, Benjamin.
Yes, I think our session is coming to an end. I just want to say a big thank you, Dr. Radisa, for being with us. Well, we didn't exhaust all the questions that are on this topic, but at least we set up the basis, how we can and should treat Ellen White's writings. Thank you for being with us, and a big thank you to your wife, Dragana, who so patiently is waiting there for you. I want to say a big thank you to our president, Pastor Paul, for being with us, and to my colleagues, Pastor Rory, Pastor Ivana, and Pastor Gabriel, and to all of you. I'm sure we all benefited from these sessions. And we will continue with next Sabbath, when we'll speak about the present truth, what is present truth today. And we'll have Jan Barna from Newbold with us during the morning service and the afternoon. But for now, we are ending now, finally on time. After so many failed attempts, we are 2 hours, well, 2 hours and 10 minutes.
You did a good job hastening it, Claudio.
Yeah, I was hastening. Well, after so much delaying, you know, it's time. Pastor Paul, may I ask you to end our session with a prayer, please?
Yes, most certainly. And first of all, greetings to Radisa. Indeed, we go back a long way to Newbold College many years back. But greetings, Radisa, Dragana. Thank you so much for being with us and for all that you've shared today. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessing you give us in being your followers. Lord, we want to follow you in word and in truth. We want to, Lord, follow you to be ready for your soon coming kingdom. I pray you will bless each of our young people here on the Zoom, those who are listening on the YouTube, Lord. Help us, Lord, to be able to move forward and to be able to share the Advent message, the everlasting gospel, to those that you bring into our sphere of influence. Bless our churches here in Scotland, be with the worldwide church, and Lord, we look forward to serving you from day to day. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father. Amen.
Amen. Benji, can you